that's the reason why I'm also standing here to tell you a little bit today what you how you yourself can connect and start contributing to your favorite open source project. Now, so I'll start with give you a little bit of introduction of how I define, in my world, how I define a typical open source project, and just to give you a little bit of context, what I'm talking about. And then I'll briefly explain a few open source communities. There's Eclipse, there's Apache, there are many, many others that deal with open source software. And then the important piece is making the connection with the community. And after you've done that, there are many, many ways to contribute. And the most critical, the most important one is possibly, and the most highest one is contributing code. And then, well, I did already in the beginning, but in the end, we can talk a little bit about motivation, why you should care, why you should do this. We heard one thing this morning in the keynote. You can actually have influence on the stuff that you're using. Now, let's look at the typical open source project. Is anyone contributing to open source today, or are you all just interested in doing it? One. Good. So obviously there is it's software, right? So there must be code. But code is just one thing. Another important ingredient in an open source project is, or are the people, right? So there are people that are coding. There are people that go to conferences, talk about the stuff, about the work they do, and there are also people just consuming, using it. And the third thing, there are rules. It has to be, but I'll get to that later. Let's just look at the people. So there are, in a typical open source project, there are a few roles that you define, that I see, or I've seen in many, many projects. Right? There are owners, there are maintainers, committers, many, many different names. Let's start with the owner. The owner is interesting. It's not necessarily the one that created the project, but it's the one that actually owns the project. It has it in their account. To give an example, if you sign up on GitHub today, upload your code, you're the owner of the project. But if you create a project and bring that to, let's say, Apache or the Eclipse Foundation, you actually transfer the ownership of that project to the Eclipse Foundation. That's an important piece because it has implications on the project and also on the usage of its code base. For some foundations, for example, Eclipse, you even transfer things like the trademark to the Eclipse Foundation. So the story here behind this is, if you have a project, just have it open source, and you are the owner, you can decide any time to shut down or move it somewhere else because you own the trademark, right? When you bring it to a community, then there's a guarantee that it stays available for anyone. The most important group here, the maintainers, the collaborators, the ones that run the project, they run the business, they keep it alive, right? So they're project leads, they're the committers, they make code changes, they plan the development, they line out the roadmap. For a lot of projects these days, these are actually full-time people working in a company that are dedicating parts of their time to making open source, right? But it's a constant, like in these companies, it's a constant battle between your regular commitments, right, and then also doing some open source, but which, let's face it, not every company actually has a business priority to contribute to open source, but a lot more companies should have. The contributors, that's the group I'd like you to get into. They are contributing something. It doesn't have to be code. It's not always code, but they contribute something to a project. that can be as easy as writing a tutorial or blogging about it, right? Or updating a wiki page or adding some piece of documentation. Of course, submitting code is another way of contributing to a project. The third group, which is a very large group actually, is the community members. They care about the project. They care because they either use it, they care because they use it themselves for their work, or they care because they use it and embed it into their products, which I call the adopters. They do things like finding bug reports, giving you hints how to make things better or improve into your project. They participate in discussions, right? And they are active on the forums. They read and answer questions on Stack Overflow or on other areas, whatever you, on the mailing list, what you provide to your users. And they spread the word. That's very important, and that's very big help actually in running an open source project if you have people talking about your project. That's about the best reference you can get as an open source project. By the way, if you have any questions, don't hold your breath. Don't wait till the end, just raise your hand. We can, whatever you like. Let's look at a few open source communities. There are many, many out there, but before I get into a few examples, I think, or at least I'd like to discuss a little bit the values of a community. Like, why do we need to have a community? I can just run the project by myself. Yes, you can run a project by yourself, but the communities are there to help you. So for example, if you take a project, or if you have a project, go to one of the large communities, you immediately have a big outreach, right? Because you'll participate in the brand and the awareness of that community. Some communities, for example, Apache and Eclipse, they define, they have a strong governance model. They actually define a development process that ensures that the contribution and the development of the projects follow some certain guidelines. Other communities, for example, such as GitHub, they mainly only provide the infrastructure. On top of that, GitHub actually contributed a bit of culture, what they call the social coding part, the pull request model, because that actually changed a lot. But there is no, like at GitHub, you can do anything you want with a project, or the project owners, they can do anything you want. They have a lot of freedom. So yeah, I already mentioned that Eclipse and Apache, they have very strong, they actually have very strong governance. At Eclipse, it's called the Eclipse development process. And what does it do? It actually defines the roles in a project. So I mentioned the word committers. And it also, in this particular case at Eclipse, there are also project leads, the one that are responsible for entering or making information about the project public. And then there's a project management committee that that is responsible as part of the Eclipse development process. It's responsible for approving committer nominations, committer votings, and also dealing with IP legal issues. I get to that later. That's the rules part, which is sometimes a bit annoying, but it's really important from a consumer, from adopter perspective. More as a user, you probably don't care much, but when you're working for within a larger company, that this is a really critical piece. Another very interesting example is the Linux community. That is actually not just a single community. So there is the Linux Foundation itself, which is run as a foundation and does things, but the Linux community is much broader in a way that you find many, many sub-communities within the Linux communities. Because basically each distributor or each distribution has its own community. And then within the distributions, there are the projects or the software that also run independently, but are also part of the larger community. So it's pretty big but it's also pretty easy to get or to connect to, right? Because you just touch one area and then you suddenly get right down into the project if you want to. GitHub, I mentioned, they mainly provide the infrastructure, which, by the way, all the others do too, except for Linux. There is a little bit difference in that a lot of the infrastructure is shared, so some distributors provide infrastructure, and some use infrastructure provided by the Linux Foundation, for example, for developing the Linux kernel itself. OpenGDK is a community created by Oracle around the developing in Java, develop GRE. That's an interesting community as well. It's mainly, the reason here is it's mainly driven by companies. There are a few individuals, but the goal of this community of OpenJDK is actually to have a group of companies collaborating together, which otherwise would never work together on a single item. So one important thing about GitHub is there are many, many projects on GitHub, but if you think about contributing, keep looking if they actually pick the license. Because if they never pick the license and if there's no license information in there, it's not an open source project. You can look at the code, but legally you actually have no permissions to use the code. Right, because you need to have a license in place, an open source license, or even just a short statement that says the code is public domain, then you're good to work with it. So you wanna actually start developing open source or actually help contribute to a project. And the way that is achieved is by really connecting with a community. It will never work if you just write a big chunk of code, throw it over the fence and say, that's it, go do it, right? It's actually hard work lobbying or discussing with the developers to make them aware that you want to contribute something, that you're working on that piece of technology and that you want to bring it into the project. So in order to get to that, you need to start connecting with the community. And that's actually the way I started, is helping other users. So back in the early days, in 2001, when I first downloaded Eclipse after IBM made it open source, there was a forum, there was some Stack Overflow, there was some news groups, and mailing lists were mainly used by the developers to discuss the implementation, the development of the project itself. But in the news groups, there was the only place to actually discuss and meet people and answer, but just by answering their questions. And with that, you start building a reputation, right? Your name show up a couple of times, and the developers, they will actually realize that. Next step I took is reporting problems. Usually an open source project has a public bug tracking system. For Apaches, it's Jira, it's issue.apache.org. Issues.apache.org. For Eclipse, it's bugs.eclipse.org, for example. At GitHub, there's usually a tab for the issues within a project. Some projects use it, some projects have an external system. So it's really challenging or troubling sometimes already to find out where you start connecting with the community. Luckily, these days, a lot of things are easier because really if you want to help users, you just go to Stack Overflow. There's a pretty high chance that a lot of users and developers will ask questions about a particular project they are. So that's a good place to actually start helping people. And it's also a good place to make your reputation visible. Once you get into reporting problems, it's not just by simply complaining that something is not working, it's actually really identifying or showing developers how to reproduce a problem and then also discussing with them the actual implementation or the actual or a potential fix, right? And if you do that not just one time, but many, many more bug reports over the months or weeks or months or years, then again, they start recognizing the name because they interact with you. Third thing you can do is go to conferences. You don't necessarily have to speak, but talking at conferences is also a good way to actually connect with the community because, as you see in the next picture, there are many, many people. There are actually the community members of the project, and then you can have lively discussions with each of them, not just with users, but also with the developers. It's another way, just socializing with them, talking, and brainstorming ideas, right? Or just talk about other great things. And the more you do that, the more you socialize, the more you network, the more you communicate with the developers, the easier it actually is for you to get code accepted. Because really what you're doing is you're building a level of trust with the community, with the team. And when you're ready to start contributing code, then the hard part begins. I say hard because it's information that is not obvious. I had to learn it like a long way till I actually understood all the pieces and bits, till I finally managed to have my first contribution showing up at Eclipse, or my code contribution. A lot of projects have coding conventions. Sometimes they are not really well documented or easily accessible, but hidden way deep into some different location or some very deep location folder structure inside the source code system. There are stuff like, for example, formatting settings that you can import into your IDE. It can be really frustrating at first, because when I started submitting, for example, for the JGit project, which is a Java-based Git implementation, like nearly all of my reviews, like the first one, got immediately rejected because I had things like a trailing white space in the line, right? So if you, like, committers are humans, and sometimes they are very particular, or some committers are more particular than others. But again, that's something that, from working with other people in a company, it's similar. Right? There's always something. There are always some people which are more particular than others. I think the really message is, don't try to change the existing project coding conventions and formatting with your first contributions. Actually, it is possible, and we had this. In the JGit project, that later on, a contributor, not even a committer, started a discussion about changing some coding conventions, and it turned out that the majority of committer actually liked it, right? So even as a contributor, you can change. You have an influence on the project. Now this isn't a functional influence, but it simplifies. It simplifies now life for others if you get closer to the more common coding conventions, because they had really some special one. Yeah, license, I already mentioned, it's very important to pick a license. And you need to review the license, what it mandates from you, from the contribution, because sometimes it does. Sometimes it doesn't, sometimes it does. Intellectual property, copyright. That is also very important, mostly if you are working for a company. I get to that later. Third-party libraries. For a lot of projects, they actually don't care. But the Eclipse Foundation, for example, they have a whole team that's reviewing the usage of third-party libraries. And they do that for a reason that the community members of the projects can assume that there's a low risk of consuming the projects, of using the project. So you really have to think about this and actually accept or make compromises before you start contributing. Otherwise, your contribution will fail, guaranteed. So you need to look into, when I say following the project guides and convention, you need to look if there's a process already defined for contribution. For GitHub, it's really easy, because really a lot of projects, they are there because they want the pull requests. Apache took years, but they also now have Git repositories available, which are available on GitHub, so you could also do pull requests. Eclipse has a Garrett instance. They do Garrett reviews, but Garrett reviews comes out of the Android ecosystem or the Android open source community. It's a tool that they use for reviewing code in Android. Android, by the way, is another very interesting community. It's an open source project. You can do small code contributions, but mainly a lot of development within the companies or within Google actually happens internally, not visible to us, right, to the public. They just release it from time to time. So the Garrett review model has a steep learning curve to get into. So the Eclipse Foundation also realized that it, just because the GitHub pull request model is so popular, that they also allow GitHub contributions. But again, this is where it gets complicated. The project is allowed to pick, or actually the maintainers of the project are allowed to decide, right? So for some projects, they use Git and Garrett. Others use Git and pull requests, even though they're an Eclipse project. But the majority is Git-based these days. Patch size is another interesting thing. Usually, what I've learned is that projects tend to have smaller sizes, and that they are really just address one concern. So even though you're fixing a bug, you see a different problem, don't try to change it in the same commit or in the same patch. That really confuses, like that will just cause confusion and more discussion with developers. So try to focus on the actual change, and if you see another problem, force yourself to make a separate change. I actually had to, that was not my style of working. Usually when I change code and see another problem, I just fix it right away and commit it. It's not always the best way. So it actually also helped myself to work in a better process and have separate changes that can then be merged and cherry-picked individually. Another important thing are unit tests, right? Some projects require to have run in union test. So even though, to give an example, the other day I was preparing a fix with some Java class loading issues. Very annoying for a library, the bytecode, some bytecode library, which was on SourceForge previously, but then went to GitHub and was pretty inactive during the time. Inactive in a way that it was still being used by a lot of folks out there, but not really maintained anymore because it was stable. Nothing had to change. The problem is, over time, because it's a long library, they had initially a build system in Ant, and then a new build system in Gradle. And really, all I wanted to do is just a simple class loader fix, two lines of changes. But I ended up re-implementing parts of the Ant build in the Gradle build because the committer wanted to have all the tests run in the new Gradle build. Which, if you have to sometimes, I mean that. It's a bad decision, in my opinion, what the maintainers did back then. But sometimes you have to accept that projects that work that way. So your only option then is, if you don't want to go the long way and re-implement parts of their build or refactor parts of the other software, the only option you have in the end is forking the project and doing the change yourself. That's what we did internally because we had some time constraints, but I continued working upstream with a project to have the proper fix in place. But that gets us back to the last point, which is the most important one, communication and expectations. It's really good if the developers know ahead of time that you're working onto something, that you're working on something, that you plan on contributing something, and then you start discussing with them how to actually implement it. Because if they are aware of it, they can plan time, they can factor in time into their own planning to review the changes that you are proposing. And that's actually a hard part, is to get attention from the developers. But if you did the first steps in the beginning, active in the community, help users, participating in discussions, or even connected personally, socialized with the developers, and they know your name, it's much easier than if you just show up out of the dark, submit 1,000 lines of changes, and be silent. That's actually a guarantee that those changes will never make it into a project. Because a lot of projects, they are concerned that, not so much for bug fixes, but for new functionality that gets added, that they want to see that the contributor has an interest in maintaining that functionality. And if you do that, that's actually going the next mile to become then a committer of the project itself. Then you're no longer just a contributor. One slide about intellectual property, the boring rule stuff, but that's very important. Like, you have to ask a couple of questions when you start contributing, like, how's the project license? Sometimes it's dual licensed, sometimes not. You need to make sure that you need to clarify who owns the code that you contributed, that you wrote, that you contribute. In some employment agreements, the copyright immediately goes to your employer. Then it's not your decision to contribute the code, right? You have to get approval from your employer to contribute it, which actually means to relicense the code that you are submitting. And that's why a lot of those open source communities have these CLAs, contributor license agreements. It's really just a way to ensuring that there is a good that there is proper provenance, improvement of the code, where it's coming from. And that you then certify that you have the right to contribute it. Eclipse, for example, has multiple levels of CLAs. You can sign an individual CLA. That's really easy, just one click for anything that you personally wrote in your time that you own the copyright, and then you can just contribute it. But Eclipse also offers whole companies to have CLAs in place. They call it member agreements. I know that some of the larger members, they have full agreements, so you can easily, as an employee of that company, you can easily contribute to any project that is at Eclipse, for example. In the early days, I remember when I contributed to the GWT project, the Google Web Toolkit, I actually had to sign a CLA by hand and then fax it to some random fax number in California. And 2 days later, I actually asked on the bug report if it's now okay to accept it, and they said, yep, paperwork received. So apparently there's some process here that wasn't clear, but really companies just want to make sure that you're following the process. And that's also why some are reviewing third-party libraries very carefully. For example, I don't know who of you develops in Java. There's a very popular library for daytime called Yoda Daytime Library. Unfortunately, we can't use that library at Eclipse, because it turns out that in the early days, the maintainer of the library did a poor job in tracking where code contributions came from, right? So they are basically just, that's the worst thing you can do, is sending code directly to an email to some committer or to someone. Because then it isn't clear if that gets committed, where it's coming from. So that's why a lot of projects have these processes in place. You need to go to a bug tracking system to either upload a patch, or you need to go to GitHub or Garrett to submit a pull request or review that they can then work on and verify that you can contribute it. All right. Yeah, and that's mostly it. The last slide is mainly about the motivation, why I think you should care contributing is. And the important message is what I heard in the keynote this morning. You get a chance to influence the project, and I'd like to add another one. You get a chance to meet really great people. Like in this 13 years since I've started doing this, I met so many great people at conferences or at hackathons or at demo camps, which I never believed I would actually doing this, because like the area I'm based in Germany is a small town with 20,000 people, right? I work for small companies, or in the early days, I work for smaller companies. We're a small group, everyone knows it. I actually, like my parents I live still in the same town I was born in. Today, and this is also because of open source, I work for Tasktop Technologies, which is headquartered in Vancouver. I work remote most of the time. But again, the CEO, I met him 2006 in San Francisco at EclipseCon at a conference. Back then, he was a graduate student writing on the Eclipse Milan open source project, right? And we exchanged a little bit of ideas. And then like 2 years ago, we decided to work together on this stuff. And this is really what open source can do, which I think is impossible if you just live in a closed shop world model. All right, that's it. If you have any questions, otherwise, thanks a lot for showing up.